This video is sponsored by Squarespace. In most of the English-speaking world, this delightful, relatively low-alcohol fizzy drink made from apples is known as cider. Here in the United States, we call this cider. This is also made from apples, but it has no alcohol at all, and it is not fizzy. We have the fizzy, boozy stuff here in the United States, too. In fact, it's actually been the fastest growing segment of our alcohol market now for over a decade. But we do not call it cider. Instead, we call it hard cider. This we call cider, and this we call apple juice. And when it comes to food and drink, this is one of the most divergent features of United Statesian English. No other Anglophones anywhere else in the world distinguish between these three products in the same way that we do, with the possible exception of a few confused Canadians under our dubious influence. Why do we call this hard cider? What exactly is hard about it? And what is even the difference between American apple cider and apple juice? Come, friends, let us seek these answers together. Historically, even apple hasn't always meant apple, not in English, not in lots of Indo-European languages. The word we use for apples today was once a generic word for pretty much any fruit. And in this sense, fruit is a generic word for any edible bulbous growth on a plant, not just the ones that meet the strict botanical definition of fruit. All of this is to explain why the French still use their word for apple to describe potatoes. Pomme de terre, apple of the earth. That's what they call potatoes in French. And because French is generally regarded as high class within Anglophone society, English-speaking chefs will often list mashed potatoes on their menu as pomme purée. And I've always wondered why pomme purée describes mashed potatoes and not applesauce, and now I know. Anyway, in English, they use the word apple to describe any fruit as recently as the 17th century. This is despite the fact that Malus domestica here had been very popular in Britain since at least Roman times. The wild ancestor of the apple is native to Central Asia. Alma is the Kazakh word for apple, hence Almaty, Appletown. But the Romans spread domesticated varieties all over their empire. Subsequent Germanic settlers in England loved apples, and then the French-speaking Normans brought even more varieties to Britain following their conquest of 1066. Indeed, apples were referred to as pomme in English well into the modern period. Apples and pears. And apples loved Britain. Perfect climate there for the trees. And the Brits grew so-called dessert apples for eating, like this. It's a dessert apple, one you just eat. And they also grew cider apples for juicing. According to the Oxford English Dictionary here, cider and its etymological ancestors have basically always referred to some kind of alcoholic beverage, going back to the Hebrew word shekar. Leviticus 10:8. And the Lord spake unto Aaron, saying, do not drink wine nor strong drink when you go into the tabernacle. Strong drink, or intoxicant in Hebrew, was shekar. Latin Christians translated that to sicera, which became cedro in Italian, and cidra in Spanish, and sidua, or something, in Old French. And then the Normans brought that to England, where it became cider. The OED's first record of the term apple juice is from early modern English. I can't find any Middle English term to describe the non-alcoholic product. And maybe there's a reason for that. Apple juice wants to become alcoholic. That is arguably its natural state. Where I grew up in central Pennsylvania, there was an orchard down the way from us that sold unfiltered apple juice pressed from late season apples. This is what we call cider in the United States, unfiltered or cloudy apple juice. And because the stuff we got from that orchard was also unpasteurized, it had not been heated to the point of killing all the microorganisms in here, my older brother Tony would just take these jugs and he'd put them into his bedroom closet and let them ferment. You did nothing to them, just held them there at room temperature in his closet. And after a few weeks, the tops would start to kind of buckle from all of the CO2 pressure building up in here, and then he would drink it. It was probably a relatively low alcohol, sparkly cider. For the record, kids, I don't recommend that. There's also a lot of bacteria that could propagate in there. But anyway, apples are naturally covered in yeast. If you take unwashed apples off the tree and you smash them into juice and don't boil it or do anything else to it, within a couple of weeks, it'll probably be a weak weak alcoholic beverage. And historically, people would have allowed that to happen to make this a safer drink. Like we said, there's also potentially some bad bacteria on the apples, and the alcohol can help control those. The result is a nutritious, tasty drink that may be safer than the average peasant's local water supply, and that has a low enough alcohol content that you can give it to children, which they did. All of this is to say is that until very recently, cider has always been a word that meant apple beer. Well, technically, I guess it's closer to wine than it is to beer, though most stuff on the market is carbonated and maybe 5 to 10% alcohol, like beer, so I think in effect it's closer to beer. Over here at Maryville College, the beer brewing chemistry professor, Dr. Nathan Duncan, is making his first hard cider, as we Americans would call it, hard cider. He's got pasteurized apple juice there.
This is from Honeycrisp apples, not from concentrate. I read online that this is a good way to make cider if you're making it for the first time.
They heated it at the processing plant to kill any microorganisms, including the yeast, so he's got to add yeast back in.
So for this one, I am going to use a British ale yeast that I also read online that some people say makes really good ciders that are well-rounded. So I don't know.
It's just an experiment, and here it is a few weeks later.
This is just fermented apple juice. It's starting to clarify over time. The sediment down here, that's yeast, some of it. It's also, some of it is just pulp, because like I said, it's unfiltered apple juice.
Which, again, is what we Americans call cider, unfiltered apple juice. Though, thanks to the yeast, this has now become what the rest of the Anglophone world would call cider.
Now with this, it's running at a little bit below, it's like 1.008.
He's talking about the sugar content. Dr. Duncan can inductively reason that sugar is now alcohol, and so this is probably about 5% alcohol. Yes, brewing pedants, he knows that's a very rough estimate.
It is in fact a very bland cider. It doesn't have a lot of flavor to it. I'm gonna see if I can get it.
It smells great. This
one. It does, yeah. I think it needs a little more time.
Indeed, it smells way better than it tastes. Alcoholic ciders are generally made with apples that are not very good for eating. They may be very harsh, very astringent from their high tannin content, but those qualities give depth and body to the fermented cider. And when English colonists arrived here in the land they called New England, they found a climate very hospitable to orchards, and they planted both dessert apples and cider apples. It's a true story that when the pilgrims sailed to the New World, they braced a broken beam on the Mayflower using an iron screw from their cider press. They knew what they planned to do with their new orchards. Alcoholic apple cider, which of course would have been a redundant term to them, alcoholic apple cider became a staple of the typical Anglo-American colonial homestead. Later waves of German immigrants, they brought beer, that was their thing, but for the English Americans, cider was where it was at. They gave it to their kids, they used it to make apple cider vinegar, which was an essential product for food preservation and for cleaning, and they converted it into much stiffer drinks. Sure, you can distill cider into brandy, but why bother during a frigid New England winter when you can just leave your cider outside?
If you really want to freeze it, it takes liquid nitrogen temperatures to freeze ethanol. However, the water freezes at 0 degrees, and the liquid that remains unfrozen is going to have a higher concentration of ethanol because the ethanol doesn't freeze very well in the water ice.
The resulting high alcohol hooch is called Applejack. And boy, did they love that in New England and the parts of the Midwest where New Englanders resettled. But it was among those same people, those descendants of English Puritans, where the temperance movement was most fervent. And that movement eventually led to Prohibition, the period in the early 20th century when alcoholic beverages were banned all across these United States. Beer managed to stumble through Prohibition, and the industry emerged alive on the other side. Maybe it's because the German immigrants didn't have the same English puritanical juju in their culture? I don't know, but for reasons that historians still really, really argue about, the hard cider industry did not survive Prohibition. It was completely wiped out by it. It was dead on the other side. From its ashes, though, came a new product, sweet cider, unfermented apple juice. And then the industrialization of America's food system gave us another new product, highly filtered and refined cider, which came to be marketed as apple juice, and so people called the cloudy equivalent cider to distinguish it. As I understand it, you Brits have both of these, don't you? You've got what you call clear apple juice and cloudy apple juice. Here we call this apple juice and we just call this cider, because by the time these products really emerged in competition with each other, there really was no alcoholic cider on the market here in the United States. Though I'm sure that people with orchards still made it themselves at home. And when we Americans inevitably remembered how great alcoholic cider is and we started making it again at a commercial scale, then we started calling it hard cider to distinguish it from sweet or soft cider, which we by then were just calling cider. Alcoholic beverages, of course, are hard, and non-alcoholic beverages are soft. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, this is a unique feature of American English. They have examples of that hard-soft convention going back to the colonial period. I would guess it's descended from an older feature of British English, where they described harsh-tasting drinks as being hard. Alcohol itself has a harsh taste, so maybe that's why Americans started calling boozy drinks hard drinks. Maybe because the alcohol they were producing was less refined, less smooth. And there you go. There's the pretty straightforward explanation as to why we Americans call this cider, and we call this hard cider. Hey, just because something is simple and straightforward doesn't mean it's not also valuable, right? I mean, consider Squarespace. There's no simpler or more straightforward way of making a website. To make this, I literally just went to squarespace.com and, for free, I selected one of their beautiful and functional templates, and I replaced their picture with my picture, though I could have just as easily pulled one of their stock images that they have available. That looks nice too, and again, for free, no credit card needed, I just started replacing their content with my content and tweaking the font style and all of that. And if you don't want to start with a template, you can just start with a blank slate now too. Just drop in whatever you need for your site, pictures, words, videos, all the way up to product blocks for selling things or schedulers for accepting appointments or reservations. And when you're done, Squarespace will host the site for you. When you're ready to pay to publish your site or to register a domain name, use my code RAGUSIA to save 10%. That'll turn the screw of both your cider press and mine. RAGUSIA to save 10%. Thank you, Squarespace. And thank you, Johnny Appleseed, the mytho-historical figure who planted apples all across this continent where, of course, they are not native. Did he do that so that future generations could eat, or did he do it so that future generations could get sauced on Applejack? That is a historical debate for another day.